seems we're running a bit out of time, so I'm going to start already. I'm here to talk about some API things. First, I wanted to know, who of you here considers themselves to be a sysadmin or a system engineer? Who is a system engineer or a system administrator? System administrator. All right. How many of you would say that you prefer Unix over any other operating system to work on? Yeah, okay. Good. I'm in the right room. First of all, also, I have a little bit of a throat ache, so if you can't really understand what I'm saying, please just let me know, and I'll try to be a bit more clear. First, a little bit about myself. Raymond Kuiper. I've been using Zabbix since like 2006, which was one of the best decisions in my life, I think. I've basically been working with it for in various companies and various situations, and it's been a real help in my work. If you would like to ask any questions later, you can find me on Freenode. Q1X is my nickname, and I'm proud to work for the company logo that you see down there. We have a company that works with about 10 engineers, and we manage almost 5,000 hosts in the Netherlands and Europe. Which is quite an achievement for such a small team. It's one of the most dynamic environments I've ever worked in, and I'm really proud to work there. So. First things first, most sysadmins that I talk to, they love automation. So everybody that works in the IT industry and considers themselves to be a sysadministrator, most people like to automate things. So we write little scripts, we use some tools and use cron jobs to just automate things so that we as system administrators don't have to work that hard ourselves anymore. That's the thing that we do as system administrators. It's often said that a good system administrator is both smart and lazy. So Zabbix also has quite some options to do automating of certain things. The most popular ones are probably network discovery, which of course automates discovering the network and putting your systems into the monitoring system for you. Auto registration, same principle, but works with active agents, which should also be more or less known to you guys. And of course, low-level discoveries are very, very powerful to automate the automatic creation of items, triggers, graphs, and that sort of stuff. Anything else that you would like to do with Zabbix in an automated fashion, you can do using the API. How can you then automate via the API? Because basically that is the key to doing anything else that you would like to do. There are different options to actually do that. One thing that you could do is you could build API scripts built on Bash using some curl. That has a couple of pros. One of the pros is that it seems pretty nice and easy at first. You just start with a little script, you have some curl, and it seems to work, and you can do what you want to do. It takes some mad curl skills to actually do it, so you can show those off to your colleagues, and you'll be, they'll adore you for it. It also has some cons. It doesn't have any object awareness, so you're basically just grepping and setting and awking and doing, and at some point things are probably going to break because something was not escaped properly or something like that. And it's just a pain in the ass, to be honest. You could also develop an API-based tool for your purpose. That also has its advantages. One of it is that it's probably the best solution for your problem. You know the problem best, so if you write a custom tool for it, then that is probably the best way of approaching the problem in your case. You can write some pretty highly efficient code, which also helps in speed and performance of the problem that you try to solve. it also has, of course, disadvantages. It takes time to an effort to develop such a tool. You probably, you might have a sort of a base code set that you can use, but most of the time you'll probably go back and reinvent everything from scratch. And it's not really flexible unless you, like build up your libraries in advance so that you have modules that you can use later and reuse them in a longer term way. So you miss some flexibility. And if it really, really gets complex, you probably, as a Unix admin, it grows over your head. So you're probably going to need to use a developer. So maybe you have an in-house developer, or maybe you need to hire somebody to actually maintain that in the long run. There's also another possibility to use the API. You could use a command line interface tool like Zabcon, which is programmed by Andrew Nelson here in the crowd. And there are other people that also have tried to replicate his ideas in a CLI tool. The advantages of this is that you can use these tools in your shell script. So you can actually call Zabcon with certain parameters, and then it will be executed over the API. And you can do it pretty quickly, and you probably don't have to actually know any API code to start working with them. The disadvantages of those tools are that you're probably going to need to learn a new CLI language, because all the tools implement their own logic in, okay, how do I approach these problems, which might not actually work really well for your situation. And it's sort of limited, because if somebody designs a CLI parser that will have certain commands as an input, then you're really limited to those commands only. So if there's only host-based commands in that tool, and you actually want to do a map or a screen thing, then you're stuck. So, of course, I have a solution. And for the solution, I took a look at Unix. Unix is basically the Swiss IT army knife. You have all these cool tools like grep, set, awk, cut, whatever. So there's like 100,000 tools that you can use to chain things together and automate things in the Unix command line. That basically reminded me of this quote of Aristotle, that the whole is greater than the sum of all its parts. By using all these very small, very specialized programs together, you can create something very complex that you can use to do very interesting things with. Most of you should probably know. The basic Unix shell also has all the options that you need to do logical operations like if, then, else, while loops, for loops, some conditional testing, all that kind of stuff. And another positive thing about it is that most Unix admins actually know quite a lot of the tools. They can read it, they can use it, they can write with it. So everybody that works as a Unix admin should be able to understand at least the basic shell script. So I'm introducing my Zabbix gnomes. It's basically a set of small Python tools. It's just a collection of smaller Python tools, and I try to follow the most of the Unix philosophy when I build these little tools. So you can really easily reuse them in scripts, which opens the door to using them in combinations with all the other tools that you're already familiar with as a Unix admin. And maybe you're wondering why that name. In Dutch, gnomes translates to kabouters, and we use the term kabouters whenever we automate anything in our company. So if you have some system talking to some other system and automating something, we build a kabouter for that. And that kabouter, that gnome that handles that. So there, we've got a little village of all these little gnomes that are actually maintaining the environment for us. So that's why the name. If you're interested, the code is here. The slides will be shared later, so if you want to have a look at it when you're home, you can just follow that link. when I started to work with these scripts, one of the things, of course, that you need to do is you need to authenticate yourself to an API, a Zabbix API. And for that, you need a username and a password. So you can just set up an API user in Zabbix. But with all these little tools, if you have to enter your username and password every time that you start one of these little command line tools, yeah, you're not going to have a really good day. So one of the first things I did is actually include a configuration file option. And the default is the home directory and the hidden file, so zbx.conf. If you put your username and password in there with the API URL, you can also optionally say no verifies true if you want to ignore any certificate problems or not. So you can choose that as well. So that single file is used by all the GNOMEs to basically authenticate to the proper API URL. So okay, so we have like dozens of little, well, not dozens, but I think it's currently about 15 tools. So we have about 15 tools. I'm just going to show you how you could make them work together now. So first example, host group templates. So we have a scenario. And in this scenario, say you're working at a company. You have a group that says called app servers. And in the group app servers, there's all these kinds of servers that are running some specific app that was built in-house or something like that. And every host in that group should actually be linked to the template for that custom app. Well, one of your colleagues just keeps forgetting to link that template to any new deployed app servers. Say that, for instance, you have a network discovery running or auto-registration, and somebody still needs to add those templates or whatever. Or maybe you're just using manual deployments. You try to help this guy remember that he needs to actually use the template, but yeah, the post-it notes on his desk, they just pile up and he forgets about it. So what can we do? So this is one of the GNOME tools that I've built. It's a basic program. It's just C for Zabbix, and then G for group, and then group host finder dot Python. And you just specify the name of the host group that you want to query, and then it'll just list, give you a list with all the servers that are in, with all the hosts that are listed in that group. So basically, it finds all the hosts in the group. Now we can use another little tool that says the Zabbix host template finder, and you can point that to a server or a host, and then it will list the templates that it's linked to. Now, as you can see from this example, the app server 1 has both of the templates linked. App server 42 does not. It only has the basic operating system template. So it's missing the stuff that we need. So then there's this next tool. It's the Zabbix host template linker. And the template linker allows you to link a template to a host or to an entire host group. So for all the hosts that are in that host group, it will link the template. So the only thing that we actually have to do is say, okay, we have a little command for the host template linker. And we point it to the host group app servers, and we say, make sure that the template app custom app is linked for all of these devices. And well, that solves your problem. You've just automated it, and you don't have to manually look at it anymore. If you're really good in your Unix foo, then you can put it in a cron tab, and you never have to ever look at it again. And if I now would run a little script that says that looks for all the templates that are assigned to all the hosts in these groups, then you can see that all the hosts actually have the proper templates now. So this is just a little example of how you could integrate the Zabbix GNOMEs with the other Unix tools that you have to your disposal. So we have a second scenario. The scenario is that your boss has negotiated a new hardware support contract with a vendor. He kind of, it's Friday and he needs it now. So he needs a list of all the devices that are matched as a Cisco 800 series routers, and he needs the serial, the operating system, and the exact type of that router device. Luckily, your template actually stores that stuff in the inventory fields that we have in Zabbix, which are really useful. But you are also a happy user of network discovery, so you don't want to actually manage hosts by hand. Now, the problem that you have if you're using network discovery is that the inventory mode cannot be set currently, which is something which will be addressed in Zabbix 3.0. But everybody that's using network discovery currently, they need to still set the inventory mode on all the machines themselves by hand, which is really a problem. So there's a little GNOME as well, of course, which will just which you can invoke and then point to either a host or a list of hosts or groups or a list of groups, or you can even say just do it for all hosts, and you can switch the inventory mode on all of these devices in one go. Now, once that is done, basically your template does its work, so it will start to get item values, and the item values will be stored in the inventory. Now, in the inventory, that's the thing that we wanted to use to actually generate that report for the boss. So we have the new little Zabbix GNOME, which is Zabbix get inventory, and you can just ask Zabbix, okay, I've got a host group and I'm interested in these fields. And it will generate a CSV of the a CSV output, a comma separated value file output, for all of these fields that you supplied. So now we run the tool, and we select the host group for the Cisco devices, and we use some little set and cut to actually pull out the data that we need. So we're looking for a Cisco 800 series family. Now, in this case, that would mean that the type field will contain something with C8 and then two other characters. And we also like the header, so that's why set also prints the first line and then only prints the matching lines. And then we just use cut to filter out the host ID, because that's in the default output. And if you run a command like this, then you will have a little list of comma-separated values of the host, serial number, the exact type of the device, software version, and yeah, you can just send this to your boss. It even includes a nice little header, so should be easy to work with. So then I have another interesting scenario that might be useful for you. Some of your colleagues, they request daily CPU graphs. They can't really be bothered to actually browse the GUI before they had coffee, and that means that you end up sending them manual copy pastes of the graphs and whatever. So you really hate them, so you decide to just automatically send the graphs that might match and be interesting for them, and just put it in their mailbox, which hopefully will fill up pretty soon. So how can we do this? We use a little tool that I already discussed earlier, the group host finder. And in this case, I'm looking at the Linux servers group, and it will show you that we have three hosts in that group, which currently listed. Okay, so I now know, okay, so this is the way that I can find hosts. So the next step, okay, we are interested in graphs. So we have a little tool, the Zabbix graph finder, and you, by using the minus E flag, you actually extend the output. So just think, normally it would only return the description or the name of the graph. But now, with the extended output, it will also show the graph IDs. This is something that we will be needing later, because that's what we're interested in eventually. Then there's this third little tool, Zabbix getGraph.py. If you supply that with minus F with a file name, and you supply the graph ID at the end, it will just go into the front end by using the graph ID and download that file and save it in the file name that you supplied. This little tool is actually smart enough to see if something is a stacked graph or a pie graph or something else. And it will use the proper front-end code to actually download that graph. The only caveat with this thing is that you need a front-end user to actually access the graph, so you can't use an API-only user for this little tool. But it's all in the documentation as well. So. Oh. Then we put these things together. We build a little script. I think maybe the comments are not really that readable in the back, but they're comments, so you don't really need to. So basically what we do, we iterate over the list of hosts in a group, and then we filter by using grep for a certain, for the graph that we're looking for. And then we put that in a little list, of which is called graphs as a variable. And then for each graph in graphs, we basically download it via the Zabbix getGraph tool. and we put that list in an, internet as an attachment list to mail, and then just send it to the person that you want to send it to. And then remove the files that we put in the temporary directory at the end. And yeah, if you stick this in cron daily, you can help your colleague reach his mailbox limit really fast. So those are three types of examples that I have that you could use these little tools for. But there's of course numerous ways that you could reuse these little tools in a different way so that it matches the things that the problems that you want to solve. So, of course, it's not perfect. I've got about 15 tools or something now from the top of my head. And they're all separated code snippets, basically. So there's no shared code anywhere. So things that I would like to do in the future is to have common code snippets and put those in modules so that I can just include that module and then use it directly. So that would make the code a lot cleaner and I can reuse the same thing. It makes it all a bit more consistent. Another thing that I would really like to do is implement a standard in on the tools. So you can just push data via a pipe to the proper tool and then reuse that in the script. I noticed that, by the way, I'm doing this already. I've got like 15 tools, which is too much. I'm losing overview in all the tools that I have. So I'm thinking of maybe consolidating some of the stuff in some core components, basically. So one that does create, so a little tool that creates things, a little tool that adjusts things, and a little tool that will probably just get the data from the system. And I also would like to change the output for all the tools to just basically, you can say basic output or maybe CSV output or maybe JSON output or something like that. So you have a sort of output filter that we can use as well. So that's something I'm wanting to implement. So that's actually all that I wanted to show. Just make you guys aware that this is going on. We're using it in production, and it's really working well for us. It's not the most efficient way to work with the API, but it is the most easy way to actually do it in quite a quick development time, especially for Unix admins. And also, it's something that other people can use and reuse in our company, so that makes it a good addition to the toolset that we have. So, does anybody have any questions?
I noticed that you're using Python. Which modules are you using to talk with the API there?
it's on the GitHub, actually, which the dependencies are. There are just five or six. It's a Zabbix API module, a CSV output module, something to work with the graphs. It's just a handful of things. So the dependency list is not that big currently. So, but if you're really interested, just go to the link, and then you should be able to find it easily. There was another question here, I think.
So hello there. Question is about the next automation cycle. My friends from Moscow, the company Express 42, have an impressive template that automates Zabbix monitoring by Chief or by other tools. Can you describe the next cycle of automation?
Sorry?
I mean that you have some tools.
Yeah.
And this is like a first or second layer of automatization. Mm-hmm. Or the whole infrastructure organization.
Mm, yeah.
Can you describe something about the next step?
Yeah, so basically what you want is how you could integrate with a configuration management system.
Can
like
you share your thoughts about what it would be in 3 years with these tools? Can you share your thoughts?
Okay. Yeah, so yeah, but basically what I want to achieve is just have a common tool set that we can use from the command line as a Unix admin. And yeah, what we yeah, it's far from feature complete. So we don't have any support for. There's no tools for maps or for screens currently, for instance. So those types of things I would like to add as well. And then yeah, it's up to you how to use them basically. So if you have a problem that you want to automate, then you can use these tools as a little as a little help because you don't really have to dig into the API. Okay. However, if you really have a problem that's big and you want to solve it in a way that that might be more specific for you, then you probably should invest in an actual API a tool that you develop yourself. So
okay, the medical question is not reinventing the wheel. So it's a tool set, yeah?
Yeah.
We have an expressive tool set like a Chief, like a Puppet, like other DSL languages.
Yeah.
So
yeah, so but it's just for using on the command line.
Okay,
so
okay,
doing things quickly. So
things quickly. Okay, yeah, thank you.
Yes. Any other questions?
Hey. So one of the tools was called ZG Host Finder.
Yes.
That's a bit hard to remember,
yes,
right? Have you considered renaming that to Z Ghostbuster?
Ghostbuster. That would be cool. Yeah. That might actually be something to clean up the database or something like that. But like I said, I started with some sort of a naming convention, which isn't that great in hindsight. So for the new tools, the more consolidated tool set that I've been wanting to work on, I'll keep that in mind and keep it a bit more logical. But it's actually, I've got a list with all the tools on the GitHub README, and every tool is explained what the basic functionality is. So if you want to look at that, use Control F or something, find the thing that you want to look for, and it will show up somewhere. So